Welcome to this Resolution Foundation event, and it's actually very exciting today. It's very exciting, firstly, because this is our first event back in Resolution Towers since this pandemic happened 18 months ago, and the exit was rather, it wasn't quite as bad as the US evacuating their embassy in Kabul, but it was pretty close. I can remember coming out of a Treasury Select Committee with texts from the people that actually run the organisation saying, we're not sure, but we think government guidance just closed down the office, so we'll need to go home, which we obviously did, along with the rest of you, who were lucky enough to be able to work from home during this crisis. So it's very good to be back. Obviously, we're not properly back in the sense that there's no audience, which is obviously a bit of a shame, but hopefully some of you are watching this online. So that's the first reason this is exciting. The second reason is that we've got a great book to discuss and a great panel to discuss it. So Duncan Weldon, who is the British economic correspondent at The Economist, has written the book. Lucky someone did the work. And it's called 200 Years of Muddling Through, The Surprising Story of Britain's Economy from Boom to Bust and Back Again. And actually, the book is in quite a rich seam at the moment because economic history is having its kind of fashionable moment. Not that it wasn't always fashionable, but people are getting even more excited than normal. And that is a very good thing. So in a second, Duncan's going to give you a kind of run through of some of the book's main arguments. And then you're going to hear from Judy Stevenson, who's the Associate Professor of Economics at UCL. And as I'd say, is also part of that renaissance in economic history. What matters about what determines wages in the long run, what is going on with all these machines, and the rest. So that is the plan. Now, there is one big danger from today's event, which is that Duncan has different incentives to the rest of us. Okay, so Duncan's job, obviously, is to sell a book. And that's totally legitimate. I'm pro the profit motive for authors. Selfishly, for the Resolution Foundation, we have a slightly different incentive, which is we're slightly more focused on what comes next for the British economy, because this event is part of a broader programme of work called the Economy 2030 Inquiry, focusing on what the 2020s and the change that comes from Brexit, COVID and net zero means for the British economy, and what we should do in the face of those changes. So what we've done is a deal, which is that Duncan is going to tell you lots about the book, but we're going to turn discussions about Britain's economic past into what they tell us about what could come next for Britain's economic future. So I'm hoping we can hold to that deal. If not, I've got an on-off button for his mic. We have other kinds of sanctions that might be more effective than Britain's supposed sanctions that it can impose on the Taliban in the years ahead. So that is the plan. I hope that's what you're all expecting. As always, you can engage on Slido. It is hashtag economic change. We're going to have some polls up there in the future. In the future, asking you some funny questions about what on earth has been going on in British economic history. But please also put some questions in the Q&A, because that's what's going to get us through the second half of this session. And we'll aim to wrap up at about midday. So, kicks off, Duncan. What's this book all about? And congratulations on actually getting one done.
Thank you so much, Torsten. Thank you for having me. Thank you to everyone watching. I think the last time I was in this building was actually the day after the budget in March 2020, one of your last events, when the Chancellor had just announced a fiscal loosening worth about 1.5% of GDP. And we all sat around the table saying, this is the biggest fiscal loosening in 30 years, this is a huge event, and sort of the danger of instant judgments.
And of super spreader events.
Could have taken out a lot of sort of British economic journalism that morning, but you know, we didn't. So what's the book about? The book is, as it says on the tin, sort of an economic history of the last 200 years of the British economy, roughly from the Industrial Revolution to the COVID-19 pandemic. And a major pandemic, a major recession happening while you're finishing the book means you end up with a bigger epilogue. So, what are we going to talk about today? I thought, Torsten's told me I can't just flog the book for the next 15 minutes. But so I thought I'd try and start by justifying why we should be talking about history at all, for a panel looking ahead to Britain 2030. And I think the most important thread running through the book, the most important argument in it, is the notion that path dependency matters. Path dependency is a concept in economic history, a concept in economics that the road you took to get somewhere matters just as much as where you are. That how you got somewhere affects the choices available to you. I think of it in terms of the not especially funny joke of the tourist asking the man for directions and the man replying, well, if I was you, I wouldn't start from here. It's not really funny, and it's also useless advice. Because Britain in 2021 has 200 years of development. It's all too easy to write a think tank report saying, wouldn't it be wonderful if we had the German vocational education system? Or wouldn't it be wonderful?
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. Or wouldn't it be wonderful if we were, you know, if we had a Silicon Valley like California does? You know, Britain is where Britain is today. How we got here has mattered. Looking back into the past can help us understand the future. Then I was thinking about the 2020s. I was thinking about your work program for Britain in 2030. And I think, you know, it's what I've learned is it's much easier writing about the past than it is predicting the future. This is the luxury of journalism and indeed writing economic history books. Talking about the future is harder. But I do think in, you know, 50, 60, 70 years' time, when the economic history of the 2020s is written, it will be recognised as a very important decade for the British economy. You know, even if the pandemic had not happened, we would have had Brexit. That is a huge event for Britain. It's unmooring Britain from the institutional framework that it has been in since the early 1970s. It's the first real example we've seen of an economy sort of trying to disentangle itself from so deep an integrated market. And, you know, Britain now has to set out its path after Brexit. But it's not just Brexit, it's also demographic change. And talking about demographic change can sound really boring because we've been talking about it for 20 years. But this is the decade in which it actually starts to bite the aging population. And then you've got net zero. So you've got all of these big changes happening in the 2020s. This will be a consequential decade, even without the pandemic. And then I was thinking about the pandemic we've just experienced. You know, one of the biggest economic shocks in British economic history, a sudden recession, the most sudden recession we've had, the deepest recession we've had since at least the 1920s, probably in 300 years. And, you know, and it came with an extraordinary public policy response in terms of the, you know, it was a lot bigger than that 1.5% of GDP we spoke about 18 months ago. We had the furlough scheme, we had the largest deficit in peacetime, debt to GDP has jumped back up to 100%, a huge economic shock, a huge expansion of the state. Not only a really deep recession, but a recession in which the state chose to absorb much more of the cost than in a typical recession. Which is why, despite this plunge in GDP, you know, the rise in unemployment was contained. Actually, the hit to real incomes was relatively contained. What we instead saw was debt to GDP jump from 80% to 100%. And then, thinking ahead to what happens after an economic shock and a big expansion of the state on that scale, you know, the two examples I would look back to would be the First World War and the Second World War, the two big shocks that hit the British economy in the 20th century. It's very, very easy to see this huge expansion in the state, to see the furlough scheme, you know, paying the wages of 8, 9, 10 million people at one point, and to say, we are in a new paradigm. Here we go. It's a 1945 moment. The state is proving it can underwrite this new social contract. It can prevent unemployment rising. It can protect people's real incomes. But, you know, the people that write about 1945 moments have been writing about them, well, since 1945. It's always a 1945 moment. Every crisis is always an excuse for this new, you know, paradigm of a larger, more social democratic British state. I think it's worth looking at the 1945 moment and also worth looking at the 1918-1919 moment. You know, the First World War, I mean, I argue in the book, the First World War was a much bigger economic shock to Britain than the Second. You know, Britain in 1913 is this uniquely open economy. In the high point of Victorian and Edwardian globalisation, the first great age of globalisation, and Britain sits at the centre of it. Britain has a larger share of the global manufactured goods trade in 1913 than China does today. It's the largest exporter of energy in the world. It's the centre of global finance. It's Saudi Arabia, America and China in one. And the First World War is this cataclysmic blow. And what happens after the First World War is people don't say, we've just had this huge economic shock and the state's got bigger. Let's build a new paradigm. They say, let's try and go back to where we were before the shock. And the history of Britain in the 1920s is a history of awful macroeconomic and social policy trying to sort of put Humpty Dumpty back together again. 1945 is very different. That time, you know, Britain emerges from the war with a different sort of a different political coalition, a different social coalition, a different intellectual consensus on, we're not going to repeat the mistakes of the 20s and 30s. You know, the 10 years after the Second World War are an awful lot more pleasant than the 10 years after the first. And if you're looking at what happens to Britain after the pandemic, you need to think, why did that happen in 1945 but not 1919? If we want a new paradigm, that's not just something which happens automatically. It's contested.
Does that mean you need to go into a crisis after a really bad, you need a really bad decade before the crisis?
Well, we've had a really bad decade.
Okay, so you might get it. Okay, fine.
Yeah, we've had a really bad decade in many ways. I think what economic historians will look at the 2010s and say is, what on earth happened to productivity? We're still asking it now. Maybe in 50 years' time we'll have a better answer. I'm going in reverse chronological order now, because having written a book in chronological order, I'm bored of chronology. So let's go, we did the 21st century, okay. We've done the 20th century. Let's just briefly look back at the 19th century and some of the other changes we're seeing now. Now, I'm going to do my book plug, because I'm contractually obliged to do my book plug. Publisher may be watching. After this event, if you're going to buy one book, do buy 200 Years of Muddling Through by Duncan Weldon, available in all good bookshops. But if you're going to buy two books, the other new book you should buy is End State by James Plunkett, formerly of this parish. Now, that's a book about the digital transformation the economy is undergoing at the moment, but entirely framed around looking back at the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution is the landmark event in global economic history. You've got the time before it, you've got the time after it. It happens first in Britain, there's lots in the book about it, but it's this huge change in the nature of the economy. Now, you can argue we are undergoing a similar technological revolution at the moment, one that's been accelerated by the pandemic. So we've seen that online shopping as a percentage of all retail in Britain is now 30% compared to 20% before the pandemic. And shops are open. And that's a habit which will probably stick to this progress, where different organisations are feeling their way through the future of hybrid working, working from home. There is a digital transformation happening in Britain. Now, comparing it to the Industrial Revolution sometimes feels silly. But I think the Industrial Revolution, we do ourselves no favours by calling it an Industrial Revolution. Because although it was a revolution in the long run, it was a much more evolutionary process at the time. I don't think there was any time between 1750 and 1850 when people say, today is the day the Industrial Revolution happened. But by 1850, if you look back at 1750, you could see things have changed.
I think it's too late to do a rebrand. I'm pretty sure we're stuck. I'm sorry. But anyway, I get the point. The point is a good one.
So I think it is worth thinking through if huge bits of how we organise production and work are changing, do we need to update our social and political institutions for this new reality as we did in the 19th century? And the final point I'd say on that is, obviously, and Judy knows this far better than I do, has written much more on it than I have, but the Industrial Revolution was obviously this transformative event for mankind. It led to us being richer, living longer, it led to there being more of us. It stopped life being nasty, brutish and short, but it took a long time. It took a very long time, and it's very, very easy for economists to say in the long run this all works out, but the long run can last a generation or two. And you'd rather hope that this digital transformation is not going to be accompanied by sort of a repeat of what happened in the 19th century for a 30, 40 year period in which the economy is getting better, but for many people, things seem to be getting worse. Then I thought I'd end by saying, there's a reason I call the book Muddling Through. So I think that is generally been the default setting for economic policy in Britain for the last 200 years. Events happen, you get buffeted by it, you just try and continue. I think politicians, the theme of the book is that politicians tend to misunderstand their influence on the economy. They tend to overestimate what they can achieve in the short run and underestimate the impact they can have on the long run. If you look at sort of actually economically consequential prime ministers, you can say have shifted Britain onto a new path, which has lasted for decades. You've got Thatcher, you've got Attlee, you've got Lloyd George, you've got Gladstone, you've got Peel. That's sort of five in the last 200 years.
That's not bad.
It's not bad, not bad. One every 40-odd years. We are due one. Thatcher, but come along like that.
Boris Johnson will be very glad to hear that. We are due an era-defining prime minister.
But this is the thing. This is why I think the 2020s are an interesting time for Britain. Because there will be a temptation to muddle through the 2020s to say, okay, Brexit's happened, what's our new place in the global economy? We don't really know. Let's just stumble from trade deal to trade deal, getting what we can, getting, you know, nice pictures of the trade secretary with flags, signing things. How are we going to do net zero? Well, we know it's got to happen, but can we not delay it until after the next election? Can we not delay it until after the next election? That sort of thing. And I worry that the 2020...
We are definitely going to delay it until after the next election several times in the next decade. There's no way around that.
That's what I worry. My worry is that the 2020s are not a decade you want to muddle through, which is why I think the work you're doing in this commission is very, very important.
That is an excellent deal we did there, Duncan. You ended on exactly the right note, and impressively to the minute. I should apologise to those of you watching. Obviously, we are slightly struggling with the sound, so I'm apologising for the reverb you are enjoying back home. See it as, like, you know, this is one of the many supply shocks coming on the back of the pandemic. You think inflation's the real problem? It's not. It's the difficulty of sorting out our sound system. Right. On that note, Julie, who was writing on economic history before it was fashionable, over to you.
Well, historians have had a good pandemic. And Duncan, I would like to say thank you on behalf of economic historians everywhere for doing a great job of the narrative. It's a cracking narrative. It's also a rollicking great read. And
you use some
great data sets, which people like Steve Broadbury, Nick Crafts and everything have put together. And when they do that work, it's hoping that people like you do this. So that's cool. Thank you. Historians are really interested in institutions, which you've raised a lot, and I want to talk particularly about capital and labour, and thank you for raising the Industrial Revolution, because it's positioned as this transformatory, you know, productivity changed forever, living standards increased forever, we broke free of, Malthusian trap, whatever you want to position it as. What historians know is how volatile it was. If you look at output volatility, throughout the late 18th and early 19th century, it does this. You have plus or minus 20% in a quarter, let alone a year.
It's very stressful.
It's very stressful. And what we've all discovered on the planet in the last 18 months is the revival of output volatility. Now, your story is one of a very, very open, hugely influential, incredibly well capitalized economy that leads the way from the sort of Industrial Revolution in forging growth in this output volatility. And one of the reasons why it succeeds and then carries on, the relative decline or the decline, whatever else can be debated, are the flexibility of its institutions. So what's particularly interesting to read about is how the institutions that are created in the early 19th century, in the mid-19th century, particularly around labour and around the gold standard in the city and capital, persist and persist and persist and persist. And actually, right up until the late 1990s, we, because of the Bretton Woods Agreement and everything, we are still dealing with those institutions. And it is only in the last 25 years that, particularly with the decline of unions as wage bargaining institutions and the decline of the international monetary system that was the gold standard in Bretton Woods, that all of those now have broken down. But they are your story. So as an economic historian, it's fascinating to be able to think thematically about what then replaces those things. I think it's important to say that in the long run, Labour has done pretty badly, actually, as you point out. Workers benefited from growth only in the latter half of the 19th century, and then only after the Second World War, where you have these amazing new institutions of the NHS and all those things which actually underpin people's living standards. But in the long run, outcome for workers is pretty poor, actually, and is definitely in decline over the last 25, 30 years. The outcome for capital has been extremely positive. I really like the way that you highlighted the institutions of the housing market as being strangely unquestioned, of the asset market. But those, again, have become, unmoored, as it is, due to Brexit. So, the question is an institutional one, I think.
Great. Institutions and actually approaches on some ideas which can end up being pretty institutional when they're entrenched. They're being unmoored, I think, is a good way to set us up. Right, now, what we're going to do, first of all, we're going to bring up, I want to use a few polls to like trigger our conversations along. So the first poll is going to be going live now. Hopefully you can see that on Slido, those of you that are following through. So here's the question. What has done the most damage to the UK economy over the last two centuries? Some of these are a bit tongue-in-cheek. Duncan, you can explain them in a second. But I want to get at one serious point. So is it the end of St. Mondays? Duncan, what are St. Mondays?
St. Mondays was a practice of workers not turning up to work on a Monday and declaring they were celebrating St. Mondays Day.
Okay, so that is called taking the piss. I'm glad that one is gone. But is that the big problem facing the country? Or is it starting the Industrial Revolution? Here we specifically mean, is the real problem that actually going first was just like a massive problem?
First
mover disadvantage. Third, the gold standard, which is we should come back to it. Well, go on, give people a quick version of trilemma and where the gold standard fits in.
Okay. The gold standard was a way that from the late 19th century until the interwar period, lots of countries, including Britain, managed their currencies. They pegged the value of their currency to gold. That meant the currency had stable value, but also meant you lost control of interest rates. Interest rates were about defending the value of sterling rather than about managing the economy.
And you lost control of interest rates because you had open capital.
Because
money could flow across borders. Now, we should say lots of people used to think this was a really good idea. We're going to come on to in a second why it may not have always been.
I always teach my students, if you can just remember that the British pound is always overvalued.
That is true for most. We should definitely come back to that as well in a second.
From 1696 onwards, always overvalued. You'll get your delete.
Although maybe that is justice because we went first as well. Anyway, and then lastly, the failure of in place of strife, which is, again, Duncan, you can explain this, but is one of the arguments that comes through in the book is that the failure of in place of strife really mattered.
Place of strife was an attempt at the end of the Wilson government in the 1960s to come to a new arrangement with trade unions, reforming trade unions, taking away some of their powers. The union said no, and then they had reform.
And some other words, which were slightly less polite than no. Duncan's argument in the book is that the failure to deliver reform by the Labour government left the way open for a much more hard-headed reform by Heath, but really by Thatcher afterwards. Right, so you guys vote on that. We'll get rid of those. Get that from the screen so that we can then just have a bit of a... So the thing I wanted to focus on is this first mover disadvantage. Okay, so one thing that comes out of the book is that Britain goes through periodic declinism anxieties through the whole of this 200 years, and it starts really early. So by the late Victorian era, even though we're by far the richest country in the world, we are selling capital all around the world, building up big... because we have all of the world's manufacturing leads in most areas, we're still panicking because the Germans are catching up. They've got a really shiny vocational education system. Even then, the same declinism then. And have you seen these Yanks and what they're up to is going on?
There's a Daily Mail headline in the 1890s. American furniture in British stores, a further indictment of the trade unions.
Exactly. We need British furniture for British workers. Anyway, so Judy, the danger then is... we all focus on that, and we're very anxious about it, rather than focusing on our own, putting our own house in order. And as you say, rightly, one of the features of longer-term inevitable declinism to some degree when you're the first mover is, over time, that the pound is always overvalued. It's related to that in some ways.
Well, it is related to that. There's a fundamental question of investment that you raise over and over again, and that's to do with the strength of the pound, is that the... opportunities for investment in productive fixed assets or things that are producing now here. There's always something with a better return, in the empire or around the globe. And when it is produced here, there's a fundamental problem with this human capital investment, with the skills, which we have this incredible flexibility of labor force, but as a result, it lacks the depth of productivity. Generation.
Do you think declinism as a feature of how we think about British economic policymaking is inevitable as soon as the start of the 19th century gets going?
Yeah, I mean, I think if you look at Britain in the mid to late 19th century, this richest country in the world because it went first, unless you think there was something particularly special about the British Isles or the people living there, other countries were going to catch up. You know, Germany and the US first, then the rest of Europe, and now we're seeing East Asia. That was always going to happen. And we beat ourselves up about it. I think what's fascinating, actually, not even the 19th century, it's how we think about the 1950s and the 1960s. In that, if you look at the raw rates of growth in the 50s and 60s, they're faster than the 70s, 80s, 90s. They're faster than the 20s, 30s, 40s. In fact, the fastest two decades of growth
Britain's ever had are the
1950s and 1960s. Yeah. But this is the height of worrying that we might be growing really fast, but Europe's growing faster.
Have you seen the French? Yes. Is the cry on the streets, yes. Like, who are all at it, basically. Yeah, that is... So, and one thing that I think you bring out in the early part of the book, and slightly comes back in the later bits, is that the way the declinism functions is that we spend our time talking about the things that other countries are starting to do better at. Yes. So they're catching up on manufacturing. That's a big part of our... or we want the German vocational education system. Mm. And we are less good at talking about what we do well. So, like, the Edwardians aren't particularly excited about the growth of the service sector, even though we're getting there ahead of some of the other
countries. There's this concept in economic history, the pernicious other, when talking about declinism. So you're never comparing Britain, you're never just comparing Britain to France or Britain to Germany or Britain to the US. You're taking elements of the French system, elements of the German, elements of the American, cherry-picking where we're doing worse, and never sitting back and saying, hang on, we're still a massive manufacturer, the centre of global finance, and the world's largest energy exporter in 1913.
Right, let's bring up the results of the poll, because that's going to give us our next topic of conversation, because basically, despite our attempt to persuade you all that going first was a bit of a problem, you all hate the gold. You all hate the gold standard. I think that's probably a fair-ish reading of what most of the literature concludes. I think we should be really clear, when we say the gold standard, what we really mean is the return to the gold standard after the First World War.
Yeah.
Because there's an argument that actually it functioned perfectly well, at least in the late 19th century.
I think the big difference is, if you're on the gold standard, you've given up control of your monetary policy, you've got open capital markets, money can flow in and out. The gold standard relies on you having an extremely flexible economy with extremely flexible prices and wages to adjust to changes. Yep. Now, in the late 19th century, very flexible wages may be something you can have. In the 20th century, once you've got sort of the enfranchisement of workers, a stronger union movement, downwardly flexible wages, that's quite tricky.
Very.
It turns out, because people don't like it.
Well, there's another reason why, and that is nobody has a job, a permanent position, until after 1870. People have work. Hours are flexible, really flexible. Yeah. So you cut hours, and it's taken people a long time to realise this as we move into a new era of flexible work and precarity and 0 hours contracts. But until the very late 19th century, permanent posts were just not common.
Yeah.
So you didn't have to cut rates, you just cut hours.
Yeah.
And once you have unionisation of rights and security of tenure, which is what workers need, that becomes much harder to do.
Very good. Right. Now, since everybody else ignores our thoughts on going first and thinks it's the gold standard, let's take the gold standard to its bigger problem, which is for the 20th century, or at least the middle of the 20th century, the version of the gold standard problem is this overvalued pound problem, basically. It's repeated wishful thinking about the level of the pound, signing up to a new arrangement, be that the return to the gold standard, actually, or be that the ERM in the 1980s, and then repeated attempts to maintain that peg of the various forms, followed by, first of all, then tending to lead to repression at home of demand to stop people buying stuff. They keep buying stuff, it's causing us real problems. Yeah. Please stop buying stuff. So we either put up taxes or cut spending in some way. Unsurprisingly, the people get upset at some point, and then the politician says, okay, just devalue. Is that an unfair characterisation of the nature of the declinism of the 50 years from rejoining gold to probably the ERM crisis?
No, I think that's completely fair. And it's, what's phenomenal is, in the last 20 years, we've adopted this world in which we're happy for sterling to float. That would, try telling someone in the 1960s or 1970s we're happy with that world.
Crazy.
Crazy. If you think back to, the financial crisis, we saw a huge fall in the value of sterling. And people, you know, there was a bit, there was a few editorials saying, you know, Gordon Brown has destroyed sterling, whatever, but generally people were comfortable with it. You know, a flexible exchange rate, which can act as a shock absorber, is generally a good thing, and it's taken Britain a very long time to work that out.
Okay, so just to push a bit on that, so you're, that goes back to your point you were making earlier, which is, after the First World War, everybody wants to basically put the Edwardian settlement, or Victorian settlement that the Edwardians inherited at least, back together. Okay, so they want to stop spending loads of money. They want the gold standard back, and they like to get politicians out of lots of the economy if they possibly can. Stop regulating stuff, please. After the Second World War, people want to do something different. So actually they want to get away from the floating exchange rate of the 30s after the gold standard collapse, and they want to get to the Bretton Woods system. They just like close, and they're prepared to close their capital accounts to do that. The financial crisis, taking what you said, and everyone always writes, you know, lots of books being written prior to COVID said, we had the big financial crisis, but we didn't do anything differently afterwards, basically, is the unfair thing, except in brackets, except for banking regulation, which was quite different. And that's true on exchange rate policy. Yeah. But is your basic view the new settlement basically should look the same? Are you still on exchange rates and the trilemma, you're still 1990s people, are you, Julie?
After QE, I don't think anybody's a 1990s person. I mean, that's a money.
Oh, okay, that's a cheating. You're going to.
Sorry.
That's definitely cheating.
But the level of support that's put into capital and credit markets at that point is unprecedented. I mean, suspension?
Is that we don't need to do the financial repression that comes with capital controls and others? Partly because we can do QE now. Because one reason we had capital controls is it made it really easy to deal with higher debt after the Second World War.
This is the great question. I think the solution is probably somewhere between a fiscal and a monetary kind of deal. And that needs a bridge. That needs an institutional bridge. We don't have beyond.
Okay, here you go. Now we're getting.
Yeah, that needs working out.
What about you, Duncan? Are you? We got it basically right on the big picture on international economics.
I think it's the domestic side, and I think, you know, the big question I think now is going to be, it brings back to QE again. All roads lead to QE in talking about British economy.
In conspiracy circles, where Duncan's about to head. But anyway, Duncan, let's have your conspiracy theory.
I think it's about working out what we think about monetary and fiscal policy in the 2020s. You know, it's very, very easy if you go back to 2005 to say there's a really clear separation between fiscal policy and monetary policy. You know, monetary policy has nothing to do with debt management. It's just about controlling inflation. Fiscal policy is about deciding how big a state we want to have and raising the taxes to pay for it. And then obviously fiscal policy after 2008-09 becomes more important as a way of managing the business cycle. And once you get into a world of QE, then that... You know, to what extent is QE about debt management? Obviously, if I said that in the Bank of England, I'd be asked to leave.
Definitely, they're not going to like you at the next press conference.
I'd be asked to leave, but, you know, I mean, it is noticeable, isn't it, of course, if you look at the pattern of gilt issuance by the Debt Management Office versus the pattern
members are getting very upset
by month,
say this.
By month.
Less for the last year, but for the pandemic as a whole, I think that's a fair interpretation. Yeah. Right, let's take one question for the audience, which is for you, Duncan, which you can read here in front of you. So, when were the most significant improvements in living standards over the past 200 years, and how important relative to each other were technology, policy measures, and social movements? Okay, and try to not just say all of this was quite important, but obviously that's true. And then, Judy, you can give, because all your books tend to answer this as well. Duncan, go on.
Well, I'll give you my first answer before Judy corrects me. I'd say the two significant times of improvements in living standards would be in the sort of mid to late 19th century. So you get the Industrial Revolution in 1800. You then get a period economic historians sometimes call Engels' Pause, named for Frederick Engels. You know, Engels is identifying that, look, productivity is rising, but the benefits are going to capital. So this technological improvement is very important for driving up living standards in the 19th century, but you get this 30-40 year wait. That's the second, but the really big rise in living standards, I'd say, is in the second half of the 20th century. And that's really a story of institutions, social movements, politics, of, you know, if you think about the building of the welfare state and the institutions around that, you know, much more of the fruits of economic output go to the workforce from the 40s until about the 80s. So there are two periods of different drivers.
That's clearly true in terms of like, Judy, you go first before
I
start.
Well, no, I completely agree. There's a turning point after 1867.
Yep.
Where, you know, the real wage actually rises for the first time in 100 years. 200, depending on which data you go with. And there's a turning point post 45. Which is about social investment, social and welfare investment generally, and both produce a much higher standard of living in terms of the basics like infant mortality, life expectancy, educational attainment, all of those.
But on wait, I mean, just so we don't all agree on everything because that'd be really boring. But so on the second half of the 20th century, so like clearly, politics, social movements is what gives you the welfare state. Mm-hmm. And gives you, and if I'm honest, and a war, but like, yeah, okay, yeah. Which gives you, that's what gives you a welfare state, that's what gets us our declining mortality, that's what gets us lots of, like, the nasty brutish and short bits of, like, life in early modern Britain brought to an end. But on the rising wages after the Second World War, clearly, like, the existence of a union movement makes sure they're more shared, but underpinning it is also, like, you know, we've still got lots of industrialisation going on. I mean, we've still got, like, I mean, less in the UK, but, like, across like the advanced economies, definitely Europe, you've got still loads of people coming out of agriculture, going into higher productivity industries, and that's why it's not called the Trente Glories or have the sorry, apologies everyone for the French accent.
I had to pronounce that in my audiobook. That was really quite hard.
Okay, fine. Well, you had some prep. At least you had some warning. But anyway, my basic point is the reason the French had a great 30 years wasn't just because they had stronger social movements. It was because
Britain is different though. Britain had already done it. But I think the other point worth emphasising in terms of why the sort of 40s, 50s, 60s were a much better time for the economy and for workers in the 20s and 30s was you also had a much more stable global economy. And it's too easy to forget that Britain is not an island. You know, Britain as this uniquely open global economy, Britain has always, you know, impacted by what's happening overseas and this. Yeah,
although a lot less open in the post-war phase than the pre-First World War phase.
Yes.
Unless you count just the empire, what was remained of the empire / the Commonwealth by that point. Yeah. Okay, look, what I want to do now is take another poll just to give us another turn. So that should be coming up on your screens now. And again, you can vote on Slido. What we've talked about so far is technology, social movements driving change. So really what I want to get here is what is the role of individual agency in the path of the UK?
You're really just sounding a bit Marxist.
I am generally on the like Marxist end. By that you mean like economic determinism, but that's like a dangerous place to be in life. It's definitely not fashionable, unlike economic history. So the question is, which individual has made the biggest difference to British economic history? So James Hargreaves, Richard Arkwright, who are?
Inventors. Industrial Revolution.
Yeah, okay, so these people are, I think James Hargreaves is the spinning jenny, and I think Richard Arkwright, is he the water?
The mule
thing. You can tell I'm an expert on this. Yeah, anyway, they did some machines, people. Okay, good machines. Is it technology? Is it William Gladstone who? William Gladstone?
Prime Minister.
Forever.
Forms the liberal economic policy of the late.
So we're calling Gladstone like the establishment of the Treasury view, like gold standard, don't spend any money, definitely don't try and interfere in the economy, like early laissez-faire liberalism. Yes. Right. Keynes, who Duncan's book is ridiculously nice to. I mean, he's all through it. Clearly Duncan's hero. Duncan would love to be Keynes. They're every respect. Anyway, is he most important on the... He's obviously clearly, he's really quite an impressive guy. But your case is basically that he did the theory and the practice in economic policy making for like all of the middle of the world, all of like the 30 years from like First and Second World War.
And invented macroeconomics.
And that too, okay, right. Duncan's view, I'm not sure if you're Gladstone or Keynes, but I'll just take it. And then Margaret Thatcher, who in your book gets the most credit probably for, although you want to give Heath a bit in it as well, for changing the UK's economic model in the face of times. People are going, why don't go on? What's your answers? Judy, who are you going for? You can't have anybody on this list because it's cheating.
Oh, damn. Oh, I'm going to go for the original inventors in that they've had that what their impact has had the longest time to develop. And the data is there that the increase in productivity out of taking, you know, already knowledge, you know, invented little gizmos and putting them into the right application.
What's the way to go?
Yeah, had dramatic effect.
I actually had a, I think he's, what is he, like a great, I think great granddad and two generations before that who ran a water mill doing flour in Cheshire.
Wow.
Unfortunately, the last one went bust because he was still trying to run the water mill when everyone else had like flipped on the electricity switch. He was like still going around churning the flour. So like,
the classic story of British industrialisation.
The guy was a frigging catastrophe because he was like still trying to do it. But anyway, but you know, you live
it's
in
also, the... It's also the way they organised the factory. They brought work in.
We actually, exactly, we didn't all do it at home
yeah.
anymore. It's like what's happening now when we have to go back to the office. yeah. Possibly not
Worked
as productive.
Back in.
Right, come on then, Duncan, who are you going for?
I'm actually going to go for Gladstone, because I think that's a long tradition of 19th century liberalism in Britain. I think has echoes throughout yeah. the century.
Yeah. So go on, just push you about that, because I think one of the readings of the book is on this path dependency point is, so you're like, I don't want to unfairly pigeonhole you, but you're like, you're on the like, social democrat left in terms of like desirability of outcomes, how much you care about distribution, workers, but you've got enough kind of British economic policy making nostalgia to like a bit of liberalism. There's a bit of like, there were some good points here, let's be cautious about whether we're actually gonna be able to do this stuff. Are you sure your cunning wheeze is that fair?
Oh, I think that is fair. It's just like, you know, the yes, I think the more you read about British economic history, the more you realise that these cunning wheezers often go terribly wrong. And when they work, it's wonderful. But I think that sort of long tradition from Gladstone, Keynes was never a type of liberal, obviously.
Keynes was a massive liberal.
Keynes was never liberal. But Keynes recognised the power of the state. He recognised that the business cycle was not just something which happened to you. It was something you could try and affect. I think that is the important break. And I think it's actually that conflict between Keynes is showing us we can respond to these crises and the Gladstonian instincts of much of the British elite, which are, it's going to end in disaster.
I think that's totally fair. And one of the weird things here is, you know, we've got two liberals here and a conservative at the end, but even though the liberals stopped winning general elections in like, you know, 80, 90 years ago, in terms of the big features of the 20th, of like British economic policy making, Gladstone and Keynes are the things. We're probably underplaying Thatcher, but David Willetts isn't here today, so hopefully we will get away with that. Right, let's bring up the results of the poll to see whether you vaguely agreed with that or you're continuing with being disagreeing with the panel all the time. So what are we going to go? We're coming there. You don't agree with the panel ever. No one thinks William Gladstone did anything. They're with you. You've done better than Duncan. So it's a straight competition. Julie has won. People like a bit of technology, but basically you all agree with Duncan's book that Keynes was the big daddy of British economic policy making. Okay, well, I'm glad you're 50% of Thatcher is ludicrously low. Whether you like it or not, that's ludicrously low. Anyway, we're going to move on. Now, I want to touch on where are we going now, basically, is our next, like...
This is the hard bit. This is the really hard bit.
This is the really hard bit. Obviously, selfishly, we're interested in it because we're about to spend 2 years, us and LSE, I should say, trying to think through what should happen to the UK economic model in the face of the level of change that we're currently seeing. That's our basic, ridiculous exam question. Whereas, for people like us, if I'm honest, and for definitely the way modern economics has gone, our like natural tendency is to be like, here's this individual economic problem and here's like a policy wheeze to fix it, which is really important before any of you start scoffing. We should do that. You should get microeconomics and your micro policy right. But big picture, what is the UK's economic model? What are we actually going to do to try and compete in the world in the 21st century? What do we actually think about the level of openness of our economy, which we haven't actually touched on that much on so far in our discussions? So let's start this off by being like, so there's at least four, possibly five big things going on there at the moment. There's the backwash from Brexit. There's the hopefully backwash, but feels pretty present wash, COVID. Mm-hmm. And then there's a commitment to do something about net zero in brackets. Some of the action has not got us very far. And then you've also got, what would have been at the top of that list for lots of people probably writing, if you're trying to flog a book before COVID, which is technology. You'd have put technology at the top and you'd have said, that's what's going to change basically everything. So which of those do you guys think is the like biggest driver of economic change? Like, what's the one, if you're only allowed to focus on one, which one should we be like most concerned?
I mean, I am really bored of talking about it, but I have to pick Brexit as the...
Because
it is a huge institutional break. We are untangling ourselves from a market we've been integrated in for, you know, decades. We gain some new freedoms. We don't know how we're going to use those freedoms. And it's just interwoven through, you know, any internationally focused British firm, and I think your export sector matters, has been planning for 40-odd years on the basis we are part of this European project, and now we're not. And you've got to think, how do your supply chains look now? How do we stay compliant with rules of origin? All of this sort of stuff. This is going to be a huge change for Britain.
Remind us, so in terms of, like, because again, I don't want to go into the weeds of, like, individual tariffs and stuff, because that's not very interesting and everyone's will to live will sap quickly. But the big picture, the case for the economic model role of European membership is one large home market for exporting into, and so you're not at a relative disadvantage compared to other people accessing that market. Two, higher competition, which if you ask, like, Heath and Thatcher is their top, like, their supply side reform is the EU, basically. Because that exposes your firms to competition, that's what you do. And then there's, like, all of the other stuff, which is ideally it stops wars, but that's other people. That's Chatham House seminar, not a Resolution Foundation seminar.
Freedom of labour.
And freedom of labour in the latter part of the...
In the latter part. But that was a big source of, growth and, you know, essentially like a capital inflow, a human capital inflow to the British economy for the last 25 years. And without that labour, I mean, we're seeing widely reported now this labour shortage. But we do have a labour shortage at the unskilled end.
Yeah. And because we definitely have for truck drivers, although I don't think they want to be called unskilled because reversing one is really,
really hard. Well, at the lower skilled end. But that lack of flexibility in the labour market is very unusual for this economy. And because we've always had flexibility in the labour market, we haven't needed bargaining institutions.
I'm a bit less anxious about, like, I mean, I think people have got very strong views on, like, what's the right level of migration for the UK economy, obviously, in the sense that, like, you'll have met Nigel Farage. But on the liberal end of the market, you also have people who say it's, like, really crucial that the UK has a gimp. I'm slightly in the, it's really important, it is important for how it affects the business model decisions of different industries, but the aggregate economic effects are lower than the, like, optimists or the, like, anti-migration.
I go on the domestic competition point. That, you know, when we were in the EU, we were, you know, British firms were exposed to more competition, single market, all of that. You know, and I think if you look back at the 60s, the 70s, you know, commentators around the world are talking about the British disease. And what is the British disease? Well, it depends who you ask. It's either...
That was before the variant. It was not a Kent variant. Yes. It was something else then.
Yes. But, you know, the British disease, was it poor industrial relations? Was it bad management? Was it lack of investment? Was it a lack of training? It could have been any of these things. You know, where you place the emphasis depends to an extent on your politics. But the British disease was cured by more competition. Whatever was the cause.
You see, you are a liberal. Look at that. Do you see that? Definite liberalism speaking in there.
I do work at The Economist, to be fair.
You do. You are basically paid to be a liberal, or at least to write as a liberal, which is, like, that's fine. Everyone should have, like, a... It's just transparency about perspectives is important in life. Here's a way of coming at this, which is, so Heath wants to do supply-side reform at the start of the 70s, okay? And his supply-side reform is basically... I'm not going to subsidise as much. I might prioritise a little bit, some stuff here and there, but I'm not subsidising these other firms, and I'm going to join the EEC to get competition, basically. That's a kind of unfair caricature. He obviously does join, but doesn't succeed in pushing ahead with any of the other supply-side reforms, and instead falls back on, does start subsidising people again, because workers go nuts and firms go nuts on them, basically. So I'm trying to think, how does that fit with today? So today, obviously... The government's much more bullish about subsidising some companies. Yeah. It's tiny compared to... I'm not saying it's the 70s, okay? It's tiny. But, you know, we've just nationalised, as we were always going to for the last, like, 15 years, we've just nationalised Sheffield Forge Masters. There'll be some other stuff like that, particularly once manufacturing meets the net zero future. We'll either nationalise it or subsidise it, or bits of it will go.
Assumed all of the revenue risk for rail.
We have assumed all the revenue risk for rail. So do we think... Is Boris Johnson basically... Heath, but being happy about it rather than bullied into it.
Sounds like a good analysis.
I think it's going to be the.
I mean, he's a lot more fun and relaxed than Heath was. He's quite an uptight guy, but, like.
Without the currency problems.
I mean, I think this is going to be the really interesting for the next few years. It's which way does that government go? Because I think the Chancellor has very different instincts to the Prime Minister. And of course, it's quite nice that, you know, politics is getting back to normal. To the extent that we have stories about the Prime Minister and the Chancellor disagreeing about
this autumn is definitely a big row about it.
Yeah. But which way the government goes on that is going to be, it's going to be one of the big defining defining things of the next few years.
Yeah, we basically we know that modern conservatism is flexible enough to have the biggest state since the war during a pandemic, and we don't know what modern conservatism thinks the size of the state is after a pandemic.
Yeah, and you know, we talk about institutions. We talk about institutions in British economic history. You know, this is about political economy as much as economic history. The Conservative Party is a very long-lasting institution.
This goes on and on and on and keeps winning.
And enormously flexible. You know, it goes from being the party of the landed interest in agriculture to being the party of capital, to being the party of the homeowner and the worker trying to get on. It can reinvent itself again and again and again. And the Labour Party struggles to reinvent itself because Labour leaders feel the need to write 5,000-word essays for the New Statesman setting out
the
right ideology.
Which is not the answer. I mean, I love the New Statesman, but that's not the answer for anyone.
The Conservative Party and the Treasury have a long relationship. And one thing you highlight is that the Treasury has a culture, you know, of cost control. You know, nobody ever got fired for saying no. And there's a question about whether
you did
that
if it, you did if you said it to Gordon Brown, just be absolutely fair. I absolutely promise you, if you said no to Gordon Brown, you got fired.
but the question is, has that changed? Because one of the reasons why the Treasury had a fiscal policy as it did was the institution relationship with the Bank of England and the relationship to the currency, and now that has, you know, fundamentally come to an end. Can the Treasury be a different type of institution?
I mean, it's not going to be exciting. anyway, I want to take one question.
Which takes us back to Gladstone being the consequential figure.
No, totally. Yeah. I mean, Gladstone is definitely the hero.
We rerun that, yeah.
Right, now, you can't change the vote now. They've already voted, you lost. Right, now, I'm going to take one more question from John Bryant, because I want to get us onto the now a bit. So, I'll just take two questions. So, John is asking us, what's the biggest risk to economic recovery? And he's only offering you two examples, but I think you're going to choose some others. So, there's like public debt, obviously. Definitely the lasting fiscal effect of this crisis is a ratchet up in the level of public debt to around 100% of GDP, although with very low debt interest costs, because interest rates are obviously basically zero, or increasing inflation, which is obviously what all the headlines are panicking about right now. I would add to that list, or is it just lower productivity, lower output, basically permanently, so you've got a smaller economy. So let's think about that one, and then related to that is Dave Possel's question, which if I can work the IT, we're going to bring up. I mean, I was slightly being rude about in an article this weekend, but basically, if you look back to this time last year, people were writing all these hilarious articles saying that we were about to see a V-shaped recovery before we knew if vaccines even worked and had seen the first like big variants spreading around the world. So, but anyway, is it going to be V-shaped or K-shaped or something else? So, go on. What do you reckon?
K.
Your K.
K.
Go on, explain to people what the K-shaped one is, because
what I'm really saying is it's not going to be V-shaped because there's a fundamental decoupling of investment. There's a fundamental inequality of outcomes that has arisen. So the trajectories that different groups in the economy will take post-pandemic will be different, and that's why it's K-shaped.
That's definitely.
It didn't hit everybody in equal measure.
That is definitely true. You definitely needed all the assets before the crisis hit.
And to be able to work from home, absolutely. So if you're
ideally without kids, you need older kids to be able to work from home and to own the home. Okay. And then you are sorted.
And then you were sorted. But if you didn't have those things, if you didn't have any assets,
freaking disaster.
And now with the labour market moving as it is. Although that is presenting opportunities for some, it's also presenting huge losses for others. So it's a different trajectory for different groups.
What's coming up?
I don't think it's a V-shape. The fundamental macroeconomic effect, fundamental macroeconomic thing in Britain is there is a pandemic. And this is a pandemic
Everyone
cycle
keeps ignoring.
As much as a business cycle. You know, where are we in the business cycle? We fell off the cycle. We're in the process of getting back on. You know, if you look at the course of the recovery, you know, things slowed in July as cases spiked. They're a bit better now in August. Who knows what happens in September as schools go back?
My kids are back today, and all I'm saying is that school is staying open. If I have to like go into the hills as a kind of terrorist, that school is staying open. Right, look, we're going to run out of time, so I want to take one last poll from the audience. And this is going to get us back to the big picture future. This is the big picture about what does all this economic history tell us about what's coming next? Because in the end, that's what we care about. So Britain faces these three big shocks we've talked about, Brexit, COVID, net zero. It needs to deal with them, but it also needs to rethink its economic model. Because going back to what Judy said at the beginning, like the defining feature of now is that we have unmoored
how we think about the UK economy, its institutions, its approach to economic success, and we need to put that back together again, unless you'd like to continue relative decline. And if you do, you end up like Italy, which gets nice weather, nice food, but a rubbish economy. And our view is it's not worth doing that without the nice food and the nice weather. So don't do it. So the question is, what's going to determine whether we manage that? Is it history, first option, which is basically the argument of the book, which is path dependency matters, and you are starting from here, whether or not you wish you weren't. Is it events, dear boy, which is basically these big things are going to happen to us, and you may as well just suck it up, like, you know, Brexit is going to have its effect, and you can't really do much about it? Or is it policymakers can make choices? Obviously, Duncan's having his cake and eating it earlier by saying they can't make much difference in the short term, but they can make a difference in the long term. That has got an Economist column written all over it. So is it choices? So go on, Judy first. Which of these three is it?
Well,
and
I think
you can't cheat. People will be watching.
Okay, so I'm choosing number three, but I'm pointing out that it's the same as one in the long run.
What? In the long run, that's definitely a cop-out.
Exactly.
Okay.
But what Duncan highlights is the choices that you make have effects. They're just not always the effects that you wanted, you know, is the law of unintended consequence. Yeah. But there are effects, and you can determine, particularly short-term events with some effect. There is policy to be made.
Right, come on, Duncan, let's have your cheating attempt not to answer the question.
If you're forcing me to choose one, having just written the book, I obviously have to say it's history.
You do. that's what you have to do. So you have been trapped here.
Yeah, I've been trapped. But I would say, you know, policymakers, just because the future is shaped by the past doesn't mean it's predetermined. Events matter. Policymakers make choices, but they make them in a particular historical moment. Mm.
Okay, let me ask you another question that is easier, because it doesn't involve these nasty, like, obviously unfair, like, stark distinctions. In the what is most likely to happen? Okay, so we've got big economic change happening. There's a general recognition, including in government and definitely in all our major political parties, that we do have to, like, work out what Britain's economic model is. But that is hard. And we'll be doing that while big things are hitting us at the same time, like trying to deal with net zero, like a more unstable world, like what on earth you do in a world that's got like the US, EU and China, and we don't know where we fit in anymore. So going back to the title of the book, are we going to come up with a new approach, or are we just going to muddle through and basically be doing what we were doing before when we were in the EU and weren't dealing with and had carbon in our economy, but we'll just be doing it slightly less efficiently, or are we actually going to get to a new paradigm? Judy.
The former. There is no institutional basis for a new paradigm.
All right. That's pretty grim.
Well, I mean, all the institutions that have affected us today are very old ones, and yeah. Most of them have decayed.
And you don't think we can build new ones because we're too complex in society these days?
We can build new ones, but the policy...
We ain't going to, basically.
Yeah, I mean, the policy makers have to decide to do that, like they did in 1945. There has to be... And the planning issues, you know, the planning that went into post-45 started in 22. So...
It takes time.
It takes time.
Right, come on, Duncan. Muddling through or new paradigm?
I mean, I'd love to think new paradigm. I remain hopeful we can have a new paradigm, but I suspect we will muddle through it.
Yes, and, you know, so you are a liberal. You're basically like, you know, let's not get carried away. Let's all calm down. Okay, I think that is that's not unreasonable. Right, let's see what the voters think, because, you know, in the end, voters in the real world get to determine whether a new... Look at that! Look at this! I mean, the whole session is basically telling the panel to get stuffed. Like, that's basically the entire thing here. Through the whole thing is policymakers' choices can matter. Now, that may point to the fact that I suspect a Resolution Foundation audience is not a random sample of the country and may include more policymakers than average. But still, that's pretty. That's a pretty big rejection of... When I said economic history was back in fashion, I mean...
Not in the Resolution Foundation.
Not with this audience. I think it's even... My honest view is, obviously the answer is all of these things matter, and I don't know how I get to chair, so I don't have to answer. I think it's good to probably overweight how much policy can matter for policymakers in their heads, because otherwise they probably wouldn't do anything, mm-hmm. and they would all struggle along, trying vaguely to kind of, you know... think about it. I want to ask this one last thing, which is like about how the 2020s are going to feel. So your book repeatedly says difficult economics leads to volatile politics, basically. Yeah. which is clearly true in history. That's your 70s, although wage growth is pretty strong in the 70s, but anyway. But generally, it's true about the 70s, and it's definitely true about the 20s, there into the 30s, taking a broader view. So the question is, what is the next decade going to feel like for punters? And are we through? Has COVID meant that we're basically, everyone's like, well, that was enough stress. Let's just get back to some stable politics. They're voting for the SPD in Germany again. What is going on?
Output volatility again?
Oh, okay. Well, you think that's not just a pandemic thing?
Well, if you look in the very long run, that's always been present. And it's literally 1985 to 2007 that sort of seems to kill
volatility.
That's
the freak phase, basically.
You know, and who says that's normal? If you're really thinking historically, output volatility is the norm.
And that could be driven by pandemics, but it could be driven by geopolitics.
Energy, factor prices.
I mean, we definitely cannot cope with really unstable geopolitics because it's going to mess us all up.
Well, that's a given, I'm afraid.
Okay, all right. Duncan, what's it going to feel like?
Yeah, my theory is it's not going to feel great. My theory is that we've had this productivity problem for a decade, that the Bank of England, that the OBR all think that trend growth is something like 1.5%, that we've not experienced that because we had the Brexit shock and then we had the pandemic. But as you get into the 2020s, you're welcome to the long run. Yeah. This is what the world feels like when growth is much slower than we've been used to.
Yeah.
That's true.
And has the pandemic made, if you think back to before the pandemic, when you've got these people saying long run growth in the UK is now 1.5%, has the pandemic made that better or worse?
Yeah, so I totally agree with that, which is like people saying the pandemic has solved our productivity problem is just like madness. And wishful thinking, like it definitely hasn't. But I think the 2020s might feel less like the arrival of the long run, because I think there's enough other changes that will be, that I think like net zero, if we do anything, will feel like a bigger change. And some, I don't want to overdo it, but some of the COVID changes will feel like a change in how we produce some service goods in particular. Anyway, right, look, that's a bit depressing. Even if Duncan says that the next 10 years is going to be pretty grim, I hope the last hour has not been grim for those of you watching. I apologise once again for the sound challenges at the beginning, but our productivity improvement has hopefully happened during the course of this event, so that's going to sort out the country's productivity challenge. So thanks you all for joining. We're hoping to have you here as an audience soon, in brackets, subject to the government keeping the case rate under control, in brackets, medium certainty that's not going to happen. But I also want to say thank you both to Judy for offering her comments and for Duncan coming today and for writing a book, which is, in the end, what a productivity crisis of being stuck at home during a pandemic is all about. So congratulations and good luck selling it. And we'll see you all at a Resolution Foundation event soon. Have a good day.